Hello and welcome to Tight Lines. Now, as well as doing more than my fair share of chatting about fishing, I love reading about it too, and possibly the best angling book I've read was written by my guest this week, Dave Lane. Dave's quite simply a carp fishing icon who fished his way to the top of the tree. The even better news is he gave me my copy of the book, a first edition, and signed it. It's now worth a small fortune. Mind you, I'm not selling it. We'll be talking about fishing rather than writing this evening and finding out what keeps Dave so engrossed with catching carp. Also, over the next hour, we'll be out on the bank with all-rounder and keen carper Nigel Botherway as he tries to tempt some stunners off the top on a session at East Delph Lakes in Cambridgeshire. You can see what happened in the last two Fishomania qualifiers. Last Saturday at Partridge Lakes in Cheshire, on Wednesday's 300 peg affair at Lindholm Lakes. And there'll be useful information for all anglers with my take on what's there to be caught on different waters, the best methods and baits to use, and the conditions in store. Well, mate, it's good to have you back again.
Yeah, it's nice to be here.
How's your dangling going? You catching a few?
Oh, I'm having a few, yeah. Yeah, it's not a bad year, actually, this year. I'm over in Cambridgeshire on St. Ives.
Yeah, you were there, I think, when you were in here a long time ago.
Yeah, about, well, must be 10 to 12 years ago, I think, when I fished up there. I fished all the lakes on the complex, apart from the one I'm fishing now, strangely enough.
Yeah. You've maintained a fantastic enthusiasm for carp fishing. It doesn't seem to have died from, I mean, tailgate ponds, about those. It doesn't seem to have died. How do you maintain that fire?
I just love it. I think that's it. I think I just enjoy carp fishing, you know. I look forward to going every week. You know, people do say to me now it's sort of part of your job and that. You know, does it take the edge off it? But it doesn't. I just enjoy it, you know.
That's amazing. And I mean, this is an example of... Is this year's fish?
No, that's last spring.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, late last spring. That's my first one out of Burfield.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So I went on to Burfield last year and loved it there. Beautiful, absolutely beautiful place. And that was sort of mid-30, which I had out of a little tiny back bay. I mean, it's a big lake, Burfield, and that was just a little tiny bay at the back. And it's just nice to get your first one.
The intriguing bit about Burfield is it's all bits and pieces.
It is all bits and pieces, and there's always, I like those sort of lakes where if it's not happening in front of you, you can go and see a different sort of part of the lake, or bars, islands, you know, big expanses, little tiny gullies, all different stuff going on.
Fascinating stuff. Well, Nigel Botherway is a trawl rounder, and there's no doubt that one of his favourite summer targets are carp, especially when he can catch them off the surface, and especially when the venue's as beautiful as the one he visited recently.
When I was a kid, I used to skive off school to go fishing. I wish I'd have had a school teacher like James Mackay, who's a mad keen fisherman, and he has actually lived the dream and swapped the classroom to buy this wonderful fishery. James, what can I say?
Yeah, I've decided to skip school too. I've been teaching for 18 years in East London, decided on a change of career, so welcome to my new office.
So you've got a new set of pupils now. You've got anglers like me, eager to catch a fish. Let's hope we can get one.
On floaters, my favourite.
Oh, well, my favourite too. And I've got a float rod with me too.
Brilliant.
This is how I used to fish when I was a schoolboy as well. You couldn't get more simpler than that. Piece of crusty flake, hook in it, free-lined, bit of bread on one end, fall on the other. I know what you're thinking. Hopefully I can just get that onto the wind line. Oh, lovely. The wind should take that the rest of the way. I'm just going to let that drift down to them. There's a few fish there just off the point of the island. I'm just mending the line to make sure the flake's the first thing that the fish come across, not the line. I'm about 10 feet away from a nice-looking carp. And I tell you what, I'm just as excited as when I used to do this when I was a kid. Oh, God. What are you doing there, fish? I need your three fish I haven't met yet. It's so exciting, but at the same time, so frustrating. I just had to pull out of the bread because a duck was coming. I didn't want to catch that. And even then, the carp didn't eat it. You worry they've sussed your line, but, these fish are so finicky. So plan B, I'm going to try a little whittled down pop-up and see if that will fool them. I'm loving it, though.
After all that, if I'd have lost him there at the net, he wrapped round one of these roots down here.
That's a beauty.
Ah, fantastic.
That's a lovely linear, well done. That was hard won.
That certainly was. I really enjoyed that. It was a real buzz. The fact that it was so hard to tempt made it more of a buzz. All good things come to those who wait. Beautiful. Well worth coming here for.
Look at those markings. Gorgeous scales. Look at them. And there she goes.
I love it when a plan works. James and I have been discussing it. They just weren't quite having the bread. So I went to plan B, which is this little pop-up. And I just cut the little groove in it with a penknife and then just dinked a little super glue, glued that in there. And then the last piece of the jigsaw is that just looks a bit blatant round like that. So all I did was, and I'm going to do it with this one because I'm just about to restart, is just whittle it down just a bit more natural than something completely round. And there's a saying in fishing that little changes can make a big difference. And if nothing else, it gives you confidence. You feel like you're trying. You're not just sitting there waiting for it to happen. You're making it happen. And the fish from underneath hopefully isn't going to see the hook. That's just going to sit like that on the surface. And the fish is going to come up, boom. Yep. Oh, James, he had to have that, didn't he? He wanted it. Remind me why I love fishing so much. Oh, that was brilliant. To see the fish come up. I showed you how I whittled that pop-up down. And to see a fish come up and wolf it, it's just brilliant. You've got to strike. I mean, these fish are so cute. They're not hooking themselves. You've got to be right on the ball and nail them. I never backquine. Just have a nice drag set right. And I love that tick, tick, tick. I would say if you backwind, you give the fish line. If you use the drag, he has to work for it. He has to take it. I've only got a 1 pound test curve rod, which is lovely as well. It's so soft. It just absorbs every lunge.
I've got the net for you.
Thanks, James. I'll tell you what, for a fishery owner, you're a good gilly. I don't know what I owe you, but you've been a superstar. It's much appreciated. The only advice I can give a viewer now is at this stage, be patient, because you wait a long time to get a bite, and it's no good horsing it too much and losing it.
How's your arm? Are you kidding?
Although sometimes you think, wave the white flag and come in. This is the best part of it. This is brilliant. Yeah, this is... Oh, that's a cracker. That'll do nicely. That is one stunning carp. James, you're living the dream. Thanks for letting me share part of it with you. It's been a brilliant day. Or afternoon. We've only fished for a couple of hours, really. But get two of these belters. Well worth it.
Thank you very much for making my day. Bye.
Nice looking place, nice looking fish. You love a bit of floater fishing, didn't you?
I do, yeah, when you can get away with it with the seagulls nowadays. That's the problem. The old landfill sites and that, there's so many gulls about. If you're feeding like chum mixers and that, they just come from nowhere, thousands of them.
Yeah. And we still call them seagulls.
Yeah, they've never seen the sea. Never seen the sea, have they? You call them dump gulls, really.
Yeah. But they're when you see the frustration that Nigel was getting there with the bread, and in one bit you could just see nothing but tail patterns underneath it. They're obviously working away, and there's something that stops them. And
Everything's so lit above with the skylight behind, though, isn't it? It's so obvious, I think, to them. You see them when they take all the freebies and they come up to your hook bait time and time again and just shy off it at the last moment. But...
Welcome back. Carp fishing icon, Dave Lane's with me today. I was intrigued watching Nigel's film, as were you, by seeing the number of carp that came up to that bread and then swirling close to it, tail patterns underneath, but wouldn't take it. And then he went to a cut down pop up and you said, oh, that's what I do. Yeah. And the proof of the pudding, as they say, is here. Now, this is Dave's rig. I'm going to hold it up by the bait stop. There's a bait stop there that holds the bait in place, and this is a cut down.
Yeah, it's just whittled down to helps to sort of look a bit like a chum mixer, because that's or a pellet, because that's normally what you feed as loose feed.
That's what you'd be feeding. And compared to bottom rigs, it's a much, much smaller hook. Do you think the fish see the hook? Do you think that the
I think there's a possibility, yeah. And also I want a light hook, you know. I don't want something heavy, so it's fairly fine wire, but they're quite strong. It's a size, I think that one's a 10, and I'll go down to a 12.
Would you? And the line's quite thin as well. I mean, when you think that a normal hook length for carp fishing would probably be 25 pounds or braid, and the main line would be 18 or 20 pound.
Yeah.
Here you've got, I don't know, it's 3 kilos.
It's 3.2 or something like that. Yeah.
Very thin. Yeah. And do you have, I'm going to hide this, hide this for a second or two. Do you have a fixed length that you like to use? Do you like a fly angler would try and do, turn his fly over away from the end of the line?
Yeah, I do. I generally fish to have separation between the controller and the hook bait, although why, I don't know, because if a fish comes into a swim, 9 times out of 10, first thing it looks at is the controller.
You spoiled it, because I was just going to say, I mean, this is the controller.
Yeah.
And you look at that, and that's weighted at this end, so it will cast, but it floats on the surface.
It's flat, yeah.
Sits like that. And the whole object of this is what? Is it?
It's it's initially to prick the hook in.
So it's
like
almost a
bolt rig sort of thing.
And it's trapped with this bead, and this bead, I take it, would slide off?
It will. It's not slid on through the hole in the bead. I've put a baiting needle crosswise, so that it's like a float
like
stop.
A rubber bead,
A normal float stop would do the same job.
But like you said, the amazing thing is the number of times a carp will come up and go... try and eat it.
Yeah. I mean, I have caught in the past using a sinking bait and a 1 or 2 inch... when they just on busy waters and they keep taking the controller. I thought,
I remember Matt Hayes and his slice of bread rig, where he put a bit of bread on the hook and then rolled a slice of bread up into like a coil and sort of knotted his line around it. And he was quite successful with that, and that sort of imitates that.
Yeah.
But the actual stuff you use on the hook, you bought a tub of your floats, you see.
I never know exactly what it is I'm going to use. So I bring various bits and pieces.
These are all pop-ups?
They're pop-ups, and I like them to be, again, a sort of a neutral colour. I've got a few bright ones which I've used for zigs. Yeah. I've also had quite good success on those in the past.
Oh, these are the imitation...
Imitation.
Dog biscuit stroke
chickpeas. And they've got a little...
have those back.
Yeah. Got a little split shot glued in the bottom. And that counter, what you can do is you can hook it straight on a hook, and you can get it sitting in the water so that the hook's actually out the water. So they can't see the hook at all.
Yeah. That's intriguing. Right. That is absolutely...
But like anything, they wise up really quickly on the surface, in a matter of hours. Yeah. They'll stop taking one presentation and you'll have to change to something else.
I've just remembered something. You spoke... I want to get onto these bottom rigs soon, but you spoke a little... One of the early days we had you in here, you were talking about the not the mixer biscuits, but the feed biscuits with the different shapes in. And you like the little white bones, do you remember?
Yeah.
I think you said they're made from compressed bread and they swelled up in the water. And I've had proper success on those. They're really good.
Also, fishing a bit of, like it was originally, a bit of flake amongst mixers is a very, very good method.
And because it doesn't look like the other things. And that's the problem.
So it's going to act different.
Exactly.
It doesn't scare them because it's a different size and shape.
But, I mean, this is a picture of a fish that I would guess 99.75% of carp anglers in this country would like to see on their mat.
Yeah, probably a higher percentage than that.
In their cradle, yeah. But that is, you know, one of the iconic fish.
The
Burfield Common, the Thames. And it is, I mean, it's pristine. It doesn't get caught very often. It's a difficult fish to catch.
It probably hasn't been caught 10 times in its life.
Amazing.
I wouldn't imagine.
But... You had a little trick up your sleeve.
I did. I'd been sort of campaigning to get a swim opened up at the sailing club end of the lake. It's an area you could sort of reach by casting from the next swim, but there was a load of sailing boys in the way, so it was a dangerous sort of angle to fish. And I kept asking and asking if they were going to make a swim there. They'd already got permission for it, but no one would make it. And in the end, I think the bailiff got fed up with me and said, look, if you make it, it can go ahead.
So you all those little stumpy trees, you cut those?
It was worse than that. It was 15 foot high, 12 foot thick brambles. I had power tools up there, and that's the final tree coming out. And the very next morning, 6 o'clock in the morning, I had one of the old original fish. It's called the original. And straight afterwards I had the common.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just
took about 5 hours of work to clear the swim, but
well worth it. As you get somehow to spent 5 years of fishing and have not got close to catching it yet.
Absolutely.
And this is this the rig you actually caught?
That is, yeah.
A fish on?
Or the same as, it's not the same, exact.
Yeah. And now you look, is this a pop up or
that's
is
a pop up?
That's a pop up. So that will sit on the bottom.
Yeah.
Like that?
Just but the swivel just about lays flat.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Now, when you think, we're talking about fish being hook shy and hook wary on floaters and using thin line. I mean, here you've got thick braid, very blatantly obvious.
Yeah, coated.
You've got
braid.
A big eye, a big swivel, a massive hook, loads of ironmongery.
Yeah.
How do they work?
They used to call that the hardware. I actually invented that rig, and friends of mine used to call it the hardware rig.
Did they?
It was like coming out of a hardware shop.
Yeah.
But the thing is, when a fish comes at it, it's coming from above, and everything's hidden directly below the weight.
Yeah, you can see that, can't you? You can see that's... So, yeah.
And it weighs nothing, because the pop-up counteracts the sort of weight of all the ironmongery, so it's a very slow-sinking rig, very buoyant, sort of balanced rig.
Yeah, and we've seen fish feeding many times, from gudgeon up to massive carp, and they don't always come and just pick things up off the bottom, do they? They sometimes blow into
them. Yeah, and they very rarely, actually, people think they pick at something. Mm. Very rarely do they actually pick with their lips like you would with your fingers. They take in a volume of water, and this whole rig will come up in a volume of water inside the mouth, and they shut their mouth, reverse the flow and puff it out. But there's so much movement in that.
Yeah.
Well, 360, that's what it's called, 360 rig, that hook always takes hold. Just whatever it touches, it gets hold of.
When
I've got
you
a lot of fish on that.
When you fish that kind of rig, do you fish the pop-up amongst matching free baits, or do you use pellets or ground bait, or varied
anyway at all? I've had a lot of success fishing one bright one on the hook amongst normal bait, but this year I've been catching using a hook bait matched to the feed.
When you look at the type of baits you use, do you vary your bait through the year, or do you use a sort of an all-purpose bait?
All-purpose bait, the baits that I use are designed to work cold water, warm water, they're exactly the same right throughout, so I stick with one bait for a couple of years, because I test bait for a company, so, you know, every couple of years I have to go onto the new bait and test that, but no, I'll just stick with the same bait right through.
Do you think that it's important that baits evolve as the fishing evolves, because they certainly have from the early days of boilies, with all the I mean, I used to sell the ingredients in a tackle shop. We had bins of everything, sodium, cassinate, cassin, New Zealand.
I used to do all of that, making it all myself.
And flavours, and you could make a fortune on some flavours and nothing on others. Yeah. They were so expensive. But first of all, do you think that the attraction is in the bait itself, or do you think the attraction is in what it smells like and what it tastes like?
Well, initially, it's got to be in the smell and the taste, you know, to get them to take it in the first place. But I think a good bait will work better in the long term than something that doesn't give them anything.
Yeah.
You know, I think they can tell that.
It's intriguing. The whole topic of bait just intrigues me enormously. Someone was brought up with, you know, starting from half a crown's worth of maggots up to feeding a gallon at a time. But some of the complex baits now are just, they're amazing, but they're good for the fish and good for the sport, obviously. Once again, stillwater anglers have been affected by up and down temperatures, but carp fishing seems to have settled down a bit now. As far as most commercial fisheries go, the margins are where to look, and maggots are the most productive bait if you can afford enough of them. If not, try ground bait and pellets, big worms or paste, but that paste must have some fish meal content rather than sweet. Fish meal ground bait mixed with 20% boiling mix makes a great paste, but don't make it too stiff. It needs to crumble and break down in the water. Some excellent roach sport on hemp on many fisheries. It is selective though, so try fishing corn over hemp feed, as that'll catch everything that swims, yes, even the odd perch and eels. No need to fish out far, but remember the margins are full of carp, so fish a couple of rod lengths out, or the old 2+2, that's two main sections and the top kit on the pole. Now, as far as big carp go, Dave, what's currently working for you?
Well, you just mentioned it actually when you said corn and hemp catches everything. This time of year, I always like to. I use chop boilies, hemp, and corn in a sort of a spod mix.
Spod it out, yeah.
Yeah. I just like to get the fish rooting about, and I find that after they've spawned, they like that. You know, they like to get out there, get on a bed of bait, and I just think it keeps them there longer than just bait, just boilies.
Yeah.
You know, you've got all the different sizes. And also, it's very weedy at this time of year.
Yeah.
You know, and you can get like the bits of corn hanging in the weed, and once they get in there, they can root about, and the hemp helps sort of clear your spots for you.
Yeah, that's always a great tactic, isn't it? And hemp seems to intrigue fish with barbills. I know you catch roach and dace on it when you're fishing off the bottom, or even sometimes on the bottom. But tenchant and carp and even gudgeon love to root about in it, don't they? Have a little go. Yeah.
Yeah. It's definitely a good method. Like I say, once you get the fish in. You can see them fizzing, you see all the bubbles coming up, and they get in there and you see tail patterns, and you know you've got something working then. If you keep an area going, keep like hemp and corn and chops going in the same spot every week, even if you're not fishing it, on the way home, just put all your leftover bait in one spot. You find when you do go to fish it that the weeds disappeared and you've got a nice clear area to fish.
I don't know if you've changed because you've not spoken about it, but you're not a great PVA lover, are you?
No,
you never were, anyway.
No, I don't like it at all. It's not a method. I don't like the presentation. I'm very, very, very fussy about where I leave my hook bait. Incredibly fussy. Yeah. I'll cast and cast and cast, and it will look like the same spot every time until I feel it exactly how I want it, especially on weedy lakes in the summer. You can't do that with PVA.
Parachute effect of it slows it down.
But I mean, if you've got PVA out there and you're not quite happy, you've got to bring it in, you've got to retie another one, and in the end you just think, oh.
Worst case scenario, it splits on the way back and leaves a nice little line of bait leading to it.
But it's not a method I like.
Now this, you've bought this rig in, and this, you mentioned weed and fishing over weed, and it's the bane of many anglers' lives.
Oh, absolutely,
Fish love being in weed, they love rooting about in weed, we've mentioned before, they love feeding in weed.
Yeah.
But this rig I've got to say, I've never seen anything like this rig before.
No, I sort of... It's a variation on a theme that I've come up with quite recently. A lot of people use a hinge stiff rig, which is similar to that.
You take it and just show us how it works.
Which is similar to that, with two stiff, very stiff materials. And they fish it so that the boom comes down stiff and stops on anything, and it sits up like that.
Yeah.
This is a little bit different. It's more like, I don't know what I'd call it, a hinge soft link, if you like. It's very, very critically balanced. So that swivel is the exact amount of weight needed to sink the pop-up and the hook.
Yeah.
So you cast it out, you let it go straight down to the bottom, in amongst the weed.
Yeah.
The bottom braid folds over because it's semi-stiff, this is coated.
Yeah.
It will slow on anything it touches, but it will still sink until this little T-bar, which is just a tiny bit of silicon through the eye, touches the weed. I mean, it's never going to balance on the very tip of the weed, but it'll get in there a couple of inches and then it'll snag up and then that'll stop.
Yeah.
So whatever depth of weed you're fishing exactly the same. And if you happen to land on a clear spot, it's still going to go down and fish. And obviously you can vary the height of this pop-up. You could have it half that, quarter, any length you like, twice as long. But as long as you can get it out there without it tangling, you have to be careful and watch the cast.
Yeah.
Because obviously that gives it a bit of a helicopter effect. Wherever it lands, it's going to very, very slowly sink until it hits just into the weed and then it's going to stop.
Even on the bane of my life, filamentous algae, which is that flannel weed, nasty, horrible stuff.
Yeah.
That bright, livid green.
Yeah. That was perfect for that silkweed and blanket weed sort
of stuff.
Absolutely
perfect.
Yeah. And short onion weed as well. Yeah. And like I say, you can determine the height above or into the weed you fish just by changing the length of this.
I'm now thinking of a match angler's version of that.
Yeah.
What's next for Dave Lane? You staying where you are at the minute, up in Cambridgeshire?
Yeah, I'm going to stay on St Ives. There's a fish in there that I want to... I've caught the second biggest fish in there, which was 45 pound, but there's one that just about goes over 50 pound. So I'd like to catch that one.
Yeah.
And then I've got a lake in Northampton, which has got a 50 pound common in.
Another 50 pound common, I'll tell you what, I wouldn't like to be that fish with you on my tail, I'll tell you. A reminder, you can find an archive of recent films from the show on the website. There's also a podcast available to download, and you'll find programme information on there too. You can also follow us on Twitter, of course. I'll be back next week when I'll be talking about this new river season with specialist angler Duncan Charman. Join us on Friday at 6:30 p.m. on Sky Sports 4. That's next week, 6:30 on Sky Sports 4. Don't forget, we're also available every week on demand in the Sky Sports section of Catch Up. Goodbye for now. Have a great week out there on the bank and tight line. Thanks, mate.
No problem.
Enjoy Sky Sports Live. On all screens, on the go, and the best bits on demand.